Hannek mi suis tra onze vating. Sva ur en wa savach. Jerekong
here.
Ban Yerak
at harvest. We will rise anew, ripe and full and ready for reckoning as all is gathered in. When you tie me to the gallows.
Almost 300 years ago, Janet Horne was the last woman in Scotland to be burned alive for the crime of witchcraft. My name is Luke Vennell, and coming up on this anniversary, I decided it was about time I learned a little bit more about this dark part of Scottish history.
To be honest, anybody could be accused of being a witch. Looking back with hindsight, you can see a sort of demographic pattern emerging. But whether at the time people were sort of particularly chosen for these reasons, it's hard to say.
Karen Strang, witch enthusiast and artist, began my investigation into the harsh truths of the Scottish witchcraft trials.
It could be women who maybe were lonely and therefore talking to themselves, or women who were spinsters or long-time widows. And then you have women who were from, let's say, quite wealthy backgrounds, who would have acquired land, and some people might want that land for themselves, so it would be a good idea to accuse a woman of being a witch. Therefore, all her land would be taken from her.
I began to realise how serious the witchcraft trials really were. I met up with Gary Knight, a local historian of witchcraft, who explained to me what happened after the witch was imprisoned.
In between being interrogated, they'd be kept awake. It was called walking the witch, where they'd be walked up and down the cell time and time again, so it wouldn't allow the accused to sleep. They wouldn't have any rest. They'd be absolutely physically and mentally exhausted. And usually they'd confess just to get out of this terrible situation that they'd found themselves in.
When it came to the process of identifying a witch, an important character was known as the witch prickler. I asked Gary and Karen to help me understand what this role entailed.
You've got witch pricklers who travel the country as well, and they had a long pin.
It's about 9 inches long with a sharp point made out of iron.
And they would look for the devil's mark on the body, which is now we'd know would be a skin blemish, a birthmark, a mole. And they'd drive these pins into these marks, the devil's mark.
If the woman screamed out, well, she screamed out because obviously there was a big rusty iron needle going into her, but she screamed out because she had a mark. But if she didn't scream, then the devil's mark protected her from pain, so obviously she was a witch.
Hang me low, like the harvest moon, for I am blood and red and swell and flood, and the people will turn to stare.
On their final day, a witch would be shackled and paraded through the town in front of a jeering crowd towards a clearing where their roaring bonfire would be waiting.
An execution in a town would be like a big football match now. People would come from miles around to watch people being executed. It would be a very, very public affair.
These women would have been tortured in many different ways, particularly with sleep deprivation, probably starvation, and quite likely to have been physically assaulted, if not sexually assaulted as well. So they were probably fairly insensible by the time they were dragged up to face their final trial.
In Scotland, we very, very often burned them, and they'd be garrotted first, they'd be strangled first, but sometimes they'd be burned quick, that would be burned alive. The thought process was the flames would cleanse the soul of the suspected witch.
Details of the Scottish witch trials can be gory and upsetting, but there is much to be applied to our modern-day society from these terrible events. Lynn Knight, a historian of witchcraft, described to me how this relates to modern day.
We think it's horrific that people would want to go out and watch an execution of any sort, whether it's witches being killed or whether it was somebody having their hands chopped off or whatever. But how many times do you go look at something on social media and that's maybe got people's passion up? So whether it's about a parent, you know, accidentally leaving their child in the supermarket or whatever, but people, you know, jump on them and quite publicly tear them apart. You see this pack mentality forming. It's quite frightening. It's still there.
I do believe that there are people today that are being witch hunted in the sense of they are suffering great cruelty and injustice and torture.
Although there are still people being singled out and victimised, it's important to realise how far we have come as a society and learn from the mistakes of our ancestors.
I don't think we'd ever get back to the stage where people were accused of being witches, and you know, witchcraft now is a sort of modern belief. It's a lot of people are turning away from religion now, and these old beliefs are coming back. And I think there's a place for witchcraft in Scotland now again. I think that these women and men who were burned as witches, I think there should be some kind of an official pardon. If it was up to me, there'd be a monument in every single town for these people. I think it shouldn't be forgotten, because if it's not witches, who's it next that becomes a victim?
It's been 300 years since the last woman in Scotland was burned alive for the crime of witchcraft. And although we may never know the total number of people executed, we can take comfort in knowing that Janet Horne was the last.
This world is murk and mud and dirt and dark and work and curse and cheat and hurt. It is blood and earth and filthy glares and hands and fire and silent prayers.